honestly, I think I just slipped into this whole day very late, because I will show you two pieces of work that's been finished 1.5 weeks ago and been released 1.5 weeks ago for the beginning of the Euro, the football European Championship that is taking place in Switzerland and Austria at the moment. But before I show you these pieces of work, I would like to talk a little bit about what is the basic idea behind what we've learned out of making these two things. Well, Jean-Marie Dreux, one of our intellectual leaders, he recently said, I think it was in Istanbul, that we see the decline of repetitive advertising. And I think this is, you know, what Rod told us this morning. It's more about how we behave as a brand than only what we believe in as a brand. And these behavioral things are the things that I would like to show you today. What does behavioral advertising or communication or entertainment actually mean? Well, I think, and it's been said by Rod before, we have to shift from hunting the target group to actually entertain the audience. And this is not just a department called brand entertainment who has to do that. I think everybody within every department that we have within TBWA, Tequila, and what they're all called, has to understand that we are talking to the audience and that we have to entertain them. And one thing that we try to always write into briefs in Berlin is be interactive. And but we should not mix this up with digital. I know that some, you know, award shows, they called everything digital interactive ones, but this is actually not really true. I think it's not necessarily be digital when we say be interactive. We should try to interact or involve the audience with every media we do. And I show you a very classical media, actually. It's out of home, one of the oldest media that we have. And nevertheless, we wrote in the brief, be interactive, even though it's just an out-of-home advertisement. And I'm sure that some of the Europeans have stumbled across it. The first piece, it happened in Zurich 1.5 weeks ago. The idea behind it started about, I would say, 8 months ago, and it was like that. And this is not very logical. If you read this through, you will see it's not planners and German strategy and what John called German creatives being very, you know, ticking the boxes. It's actually a bunch of never growing up boys who play football and had a dream. I mean, what would it be like if you could be in the middle of this huddle? You know what a huddle is? A huddle is that what the boys do before the match begins. And of course, if you want to get thousands of people experience being inside of a huddle, this huddle has to be a bit bigger than life. What we had to do to pull a giant huddle in Zurich off was first to get 11 top Champions League world-class players from, I guess it's 10 different countries, two Germans in there, to take part in a photo shoot that is very tiring. These guys had to have a particular position for over 5 minutes. There will be a short clip afterwards where the players actually explain that. And they have to have stuff in their hair so we have contrast that we will later use to make big figures out of them. So it was quite tiring. And as Andy Blood said, I mean, you have to get the FA behind it, you have to get the client behind it, and then you have to get top stars behind it. The interesting thing here is we have 11 players who've been tortured in the process, but I'm sure we could have 1,100 players who wanted to be tortured in this process, because everybody who heard about the idea wanted to take part and wanted to be within this giant huddle. So when we had photos of our stars, we started to make giant figures. 50 people worked for almost a year building the statue. This is Patrick Vieira, or is becoming Patrick Vieira from France. I think this is Villa besides him from Spain, I guess. The Swiss guy had to sit there with an open mouth for 5 minutes until the photo was done from all angles. This is the size of a leg. You see the guy on the right hand side? It's gigantic. The size of this boot is 441 and a half. And this is what we then did to the boots. They got airbrushed. If anyone has the chance to go to Zurich, you will not believe that it's airbrushed instead of really stitched until you touch it. This is how precise these people, these airbrush people were. Another thing we learned about this is, normally, you know, when you come from the traditional advertising side, you write a script and then you find a director and you shoot, and it's a process that you've been through 1,000 times, and you know, there's nothing exciting. But here, you start with an idea and it leads you to asking people you've never talked before, guys who airbrush stuff so it looks like a giant boot. I mean, where do you find those guys? So another thing that we, when we do these things, is that we can go to clients and can actually say we can pull it off. So suddenly you have stories for your production company to go out there and says, don't be afraid, client, we are able to make these things possible. We have creative producers who can do stuff beyond the regular stuff that we normally do. Another flash thing about it is that the shirts and the shorts are actually made of fabric. So even though there's too high to touch, you can see the way the jersey and the shorts fall, and it looks really authentic. And again, a little learning, if you want to make a giant jersey, you know, make the fabric look as if it is a real jersey, you have to take a completely different fabric to make it look the same. One of the learnings we had in the process. And then these guys were ready in Rosenheim. They had to be put on transporters, on huge trucks. It was actually 40 giant trucks that went from Rosenheim, Bavaria, to Zurich.
Den Gastgeberländern Österreich und der Schweiz wird von nichts anderem mehr gesprochen. Fußball ist omnipräsent. Im Züricher Hauptbahnhof beispielsweise wird heute ein internationales Fußballteam präsentiert. Europas Traumelf XXL. Mehr von Michael Papke.
17 Meter hoch, 600 Kilogramm schwer. Michael Ballack ist einer der 11 Spieler, die ab heute im Züricher Hauptbahnhof stehen. Für den Kapitän der Nationalmannschaft ist es nicht die erste Erfahrung mit großformatigen Porträts.
Ich kann mich auch erinnern an sehr, sehr große Poster von mir, die mal in Hamburg gingen oder auch in anderen Städten, oder an Häuserwänden überdimensional. Das war schon Wahnsinn. Und wenn man dann selber sich da sieht, das ist schon irgendwie ein komisches Gefühl, so groß.
Neben Ballack wird auch das Abbild Philipp Lahms den Bahnhof zieren. Dafür mussten die Spieler einiges über sich ergehen lassen. Das Wichtigste, während des Scannens muss der Spieler absolut stillhalten. Eine anstrengende Angelegenheit.
Stehen ist man ja doch ab und zu gewöhnt, aber so gucken kommt selten vor, dass man 5 Minuten am Stück die gleichen Gesichtszüge machen muss.
Danach werden aus den Scandaten gigantische Figuren zum Leben erweckt. Kopf, Rumpf, Arme, Beine und Schuhe werden einzeln hergestellt, und zwar aus Hartschaum und Styroporblöcken. Als nächstes bringt ein Fräsroboter die Einzelteile in Form, bevor sie den passenden Anstrich erhalten. Das XXL-Trikot ist 8 Meter lang und 10 Meter breit. Zusammen mit der Hose wiegt es rund 50 Kilo.
Das Original besteht aus mehreren Stoffarten und wird per Schneider oder per Schneiderprogramm zusammengesetzt. Und wir haben aber nur eine große Stoffbahn, die alle dreidimensionalen Funktionen ja erfüllen muss.
In mühevoller Kleinarbeit sprießt Ballacks Bart und schließlich glänzen seine Augen. Alleine der Kopf wiegt 100 Kilogramm. Die Endmontage findet im Züricher Bahnhof statt. Für die Aufbaucrew Momente größter Anspannung. Dort werden Ballack, Lahm, Vieira, Cech und Co. heute den Fans und der Öffentlichkeit präsentiert. 11 Weltklasse-Fußballer in 3D. Doch auf die Originale freuen sich die Schweizer sicherlich noch viel mehr.
We were unlucky, because it was so complicated to do that, that we didn't finish it in time. And that actually was our biggest luck. Because we didn't finish this on time, this TV channel, who did not only do this documentation, but also did a live show from the release for 2.5 minutes, which I've never seen before. I've never seen somebody talking live about advertising that's been revealed. They had to show figures that weren't ready yet. It was the Thursday before the tournament begins. We could all say, yeah, you know, it's planned to be finished on Saturday when there's the kickoff. But the truth is, we weren't finished. We weren't finished as we promised. The luck that we had was, now suddenly, everybody saw what this stuff is made of. And people found that very, very interesting.